Hey, what's up, guys? This is Levi doing his Altmile Brave Rogue Paladin deck profile. I've been playing this deck for a while now, and GPT-14 has really, really changed it up, especially in the competitive scene. So without a doubt, we're going to get right into it. We're going to start off with the new starter they gave us, which is Blinking Knight Milius. This card is really insane. So when he boosts and hits a Brave unit, he can shove it a soul, you check top 10 for 2 alt miles. You can put one in your hand and then one into your soul. If you only get one, the one goes into your hand. This card is so fantastic. As long as you don't ride your stride fodders, because it's the only grade 1 that doesn't have brave, this will proc on turn 1, which is absolutely insane. Like, it's a plus 1 and a plus 2 to soul so quickly. It gets out of the way so control decks can't stop it. Like, this card just sets up your ride consistency. We'll make sure you're always riding the higher DD knight that you want to ride. It's really good and really, really dictates our grade 3 lineup, which comes out to 4 higher DD knight alt mile. This is the new one, so he's really insane. His on stride or on ride once per turn skill, a soul blasting 1 brave card, lets you search your deck for any card with the brave ability, which is basically any card in your deck that's not him. Any card that's not him, which is kind of relevant, but not really though. Most of the time you wouldn't be getting anything like that anyway. You're usually going for your combo piece grade 2s, your Electoses, your brave setup back rows. Like, I mean, literally any card in your deck. It's crazy what letting you search your deck for any card can do for the consistency of a deck, but I digress. It's fantastic. It's on ride, so like, you just keep your rush going. It's so good. And then on Rearguard, GB2 Brave, he gets 5k and a crit, which is really, really strong. There's a lot of ways to make this guy really huge. There's a couple ways to call him too, so you can really, really use him as a super strong aggro Rearguard. And that crit really helps a lot. Like, you can't really, you know, sleep on a generated crit for free on the Rearguard circle. And for the grade 3s, we're just playing 2 of the old, the less old Knight of Heavenly Decree Altmile from the Tri 3 set. He's okay. When he attacks, he gives 5 dudes plus 4 at brave, nothing to really worry about. At the beginning of the ride phase, you can call a card from your hand, give it 4k, and when you stride, you can call a card from your hand and then give a brave dude 4k. It's a really simplistic card, but, you know, if you get stuck on it, it's not the end of the world. Like, yeah, you don't get to, you know, just, like, combo as easily and consistently as with this card would, but for the most part, like, your stride skills are not the most relevant part of this deck. It just, this guy just helps a lot, but if you're stuck on this guy, like, there's ways to play out of it. It's really not the end of the world. Most of the time, your Milius is going to make sure that doesn't happen, especially because he's always going to be searching. I mean, you're going to be going through, like, the first 20 cards or so of your deck before you actually ride 3, so you're usually not going to get stuck on this guy. He's just kind of there just to round out your grade 3s, give you extra stride fodders, be another solid brave Rearguard to call. That's really about it. But that's the grade 3 lineup. It's really simplistic. Alt Miles always kind of played 6 grade 3s. It's just kind of what Alt Miles you play has changed as we get new ones. So heading on to the grade 2s, possibly the biggest part of this deck, we have the new champ, Peerless Knight Levaro. This is the new Levaro, still rocking that 10k body, and this card is absolutely fantastic. Only has a simple restriction of it can't attack if you don't have a Vanguard with the Brave ability, which is basically irrelevant because pretty much everything you want to put on your Vanguard circle has Brave except for like one stride, so that's perfectly fine. And then his other effect is Brave. When he attacks, you can counter blast 1. If you have an alt model Vanguard, search your deck for a grade 2 with the Brave ability that isn't him. So any other grade 2 in your deck, basically, because you're only playing brave grade 2s. This card is so strong. Not being a generation break skill is so insane. It's so strong to be able to just ride grade 3, then superior call this with the on-ride skill very consistently, and you'll be able to swing 3-plus times at your opponent while they're on grade 2. It's so strong. It makes this deck even faster than it already was. It kicks a lot of other things out of the deck because it's just better than them in every single way, so it's fantastic. This card helped the deck a lot, to be quite honest. For the other grade 2, we have still one of the biggest workhorses of the deck, Counteroffensive Knight Slayman. This card is still pretty much as good as ever was. It doesn't carry as hard anymore because Levaro is kind of just a better version of it, but Levaro is a better version of him and the older Tri-3 caller Redon, not Redon, Albion, because it has Brave. But I digress, this card is still fantastic. It's Brave when he attacks. If you have an Alt Mall Vanguard, he's getting 3k, so he hits numbers, and then when he doesn't, and then also when he attacks, you can kind of bust 1, discard a card, search your deck for any grade 2 not named him, call it, and it gets 2k. So you still have 2 superior calling grade 2s that you play ping pong with on your big turns. It's still the same game plan, more or less, just now with much better cards to do it with. So he's still there. He just doesn't carry as hard now, because Levar there helps him out a lot. And for the last grade two, we're simply just playing four of the Sceptacles. This at Brave can attack for 11k, so it hits the numbers that you basically need to hit. And then when you play it on the Vanguard Circle or Rearguard Circle from hand, you can Soul Blast one, reveal an alt model from your hand, search your deck for any 7,000 power card with the Brave ability, call to Rearguard. This card is so strong. Combined with Levaro, makes this deck one of the fastest stride decks with a lot of Generation Brick skills popping off really early on. Especially between like the Milius going off on turn one, you'll definitely have a grade three in your hand by that point in time. So this pretty much will always happen on turn two, bare minimum. And yeah, it's a Soul Blast, but you generate a lot of soul in this deck. You're never actually going to run out of soul to use your High Deity Knight's stride skill. That's really not a concern. So blowing your soul on a lot of these is really useful. And then throughout the mid and late game, anytime you draw into these, it's like, cool, it's an Olivikia Swinger. Then if I have a soul to spare and a grade three in my hand, I can get any of the insanely good grade ones in my deck. And that rounds out the grade two lineup. 12 is kind of a minimum for this deck. You could play more. I toyed around a lot with like maybe some red ons. I tried out a pair of red ons. Tried out, if your local meta calls for it, you can definitely tech in two Hope Songs, two Escort Eagles somewhere in there. There's a few other good cards you can play, but this is like for me the static, consistent base grade 11 that I wanted to play. I tried it out with the red ons, but most of the time they just kind of ended up being irrelevant because power doesn't matter as much in this deck anymore because of the Fidez stride, and its only real benefit was just being extra grade twos that can hit on their own when you call them. And if you want that, that's perfectly understandable, but I feel it's not as necessary anymore because most of your strides, your main stride gameplay now with the new Fidez, he only has to call cards, not grade twos, not brave cards, not anything, just cards. So it's not the end of the world if you run out of grade twos too fast or if you run out of good grade twos. Anyway, moving on to grade ones, starting off with PGs. I'm playing three of the Hope Keepers and then one of the Regius. I like this split a lot more. Okay, that signed one. I see a lot of people play like the opposite split. I'm not really sure why. I think this card is really amazing. So her effect is, aside from a perfect guard effect, it's Brave. When you play her down, she gets 2k. And then at the end of the turn, even if you're in Brave, whether or not, you can counterblast one and put her back in your hand. She's really, really good. Like, you can rush with her on your first try. She's going to be an 8k swinger. Or an 8k booster. I mean, she's just really useful and like has a lot of utility and been able to be played if you ever need to, like, you know, desperately achieve Brave, or if you're just desperately trying to build a board with what you have, then you can still get her back at the end of the turn. And it's like one counterblast is really not much for it. And then like if you use any skill to superior call her, like with any of your Vanguards, your strides, your swings, whatever, you can basically search out your perfect guards, which is kind of really strong. So playing three of those, and then the one Regius, it's kind of just there as like a little tech in. Aside from the perfect guard skill, he has GB2 Brave. When you guard with him, you can soul charge one if your Vanguard is alt mile. And then if you have one or less cards in hand, you don't have to discard for the perfect guard effect. So that's really niche. The soul charge can be kind of relevant sometimes, but again, you still never really run out of soul. I mean, you could play really any mix of these. It's not super relevant. Neither of them come up a ton. But, you know, it's really like a personal preference thing. I just like to play the Hope Keepers. Moving on with the green ones, you're playing four Stride Fodders. That's basically mandatory. You kind of just have to play these. I suppose since you're only playing six grade threes now, between the four Stride Fodders and the six threes, you really always have something to stride with. Like, between how much deck thinning you do, it's really never a problem. Like, this is like the perfect number of stride consistency for me, honestly. I've never had a problem with it all my time playing the deck. Don't think I'm all in the future. It's just, it's four Stride Fodders. It's very, very, it's a very, very simple matter. Then for the last few grade one spots, so I'm playing two of the new Lunar Fang Knight Phalanx. I see a lot of people playing four of these most of the time, three at bare minimum, try to build like a back row of these as much as you can, which is, I don't really see the merit in it. I mean, it has resist, and that's nice, but I mean, it's really only relevant against Chaos, and at this point, Chaos has so much locking that it usually just doesn't matter. The hand locking will get rid of these eventually. I guess what should go over his effect is, if you have a Vega with the Brave ability, he gets 1,000 power and resist, so that's pretty much online from, like, turn one, basically, which is kind of nice. Then he has GB2 Brave. If you have an alt mile Vanguard, your front row units get 2k and resist. So he kind of replaces Red On in that aspect too, even harder, in that he makes anything that can't poke still poke, and he gives them resist, so no Denial Griffins or anything like that. It keeps you free from things like that, which is really nice. You know, it does help with those matchups, makes those matchups even more steamrolled than they already were. But really, I find two of it is fine. I find that against the non-control matchups, you want it on your first stride so that all your pokes hit. After that, it doesn't really matter because you're going to be on the Fidez stride, so your power is a little irrelevant, but I digress. It's still a very good card, and the control matchups, you just search, like, as many, you know, the two of them out as fast as you can and just try and get that going, you know, just to give you as much benefit as you can. Next grade one spot, we're playing two of the support Sorcerer of Damascus. I really, really love this card. I see a lot of people cutting this card. I think it's really, really good. It's GB1 Brave. At the end of your turn, you can retire it. Then you draw a card and you countercharge two. Countercharge two is huge in this deck. This card helps out so much with any general resource management, replenishing your hand after the big Brave turns, comboing out with the Electoses. We do main deck the Electoses. I keep mentioning it. I'll say that. We do that now. Really helps this card go off a lot and just helps you manage your resources. It's a lot of free resource management. For the most part, like, you really only need to see one per game. I found that it helps a lot when you're trying to, when your opponent is smart, they're going to damage control you a lot in the early game. So most of the time you go off on your first stride, use like 2-3 CBs if they give them to you. Then you countercharge the majority of it, and then your opponent's like, well, I might as well just give him damage now because he already has a bunch of counterblasts, and then you can just blow it all on the next turn, and it's really fun. You know, if you damage check one, like, it's fine. As long as you have one, like, it's pretty much fine. And then the last grade one spot, I'm playing one of these little unis. It's Continuous Brave. You can retire it as the cost first stride. It's okay. I think it's a nice tech. Like, if you find yourself, like, without a confirmed stride fodder in your hand before your drive check, you can just superior call it when your Vanguard swings. And, you know, it's just a nice little safety net. A cool play, too, is, like, if you kind of, like, rush really, really, really hard, it's not a GB skill. So, like, if you rush really hard, you can turn three, ride the higher DD knight, call this, and then stride with it if you're still brave after you ride. It helps a little bit. I mean, it's just kind of like a neat little tech. This could be a lot of things. This could be a third fellow, a third support sorcerer. You could try out a couple things in this slot. You could put another grade two with this slot. It's kind of just there to be whatever you really want. And then triggers. Triggers is really simplistic. We're just playing a simple 12 crit lineup with 4 Aragals. Move to Soul, give something 3k, just some Margal clone. 4 of the Balinus, move to Soul, give me Vanguard 5k, draw a card, just, you know, simple Heart Thump clone. And we got this new crit here, not the unlocking crit we wanted, but it does have Act Brave. You can move it into your Soul and give a unit 5k, which is actually really nice. Like, it's nice when you need, when you're at the point where you kind of just, like, dump your hand a little bit just to get out of, just to get into Brave. This is just free power line around. It can really, really help, like, pressuring with the higher DD in the rearguard circles. It's a nice thing to have. Like, there's definitely no reason to have it. It's just super Margal clone. And then for our heals, we have our new effect heals. When you G guard with them, you can bind 2 heals in your drop to countercharge 1 or soul charge 1. It's actually really nice. The countercharge could be very relevant because pretty much every counterblast in this deck is an attack. And the soul charge could be, of course, really relevant because we've gone through quite a few soul blast costs already in this deck. And then to finish off the zeros, we're actually main decking 2 of this guy, 2 of Electos, the original Brave starter. So he has 2 effects. His first one is Brave. You could rest him and give a unit 3k. Not super relevant, but yeah, it can help. And then his big effect is GB1. You can shove him into your Soul and counterblast 1. For at the beginning of any battle phase, you draw a card, and the Brave abilities of all your cards go off until the end of turn, no matter if you're actually Brave or not. So this helps a ton. Most of the time, you're trying to use your higher DD Knight to fish one of these out on your, like, first and second stride turns so that you can just go off, like, completely unhinged. It really helps in the first stride turn because usually by the first stride, you'll have, like, PGs and heals and stuff in hand that you haven't gotten the chance to actually get your guard value out of yet. So you just go through this and not really have to worry about that. It ensures that your support Damascus goes off and countercharges. It confirms all your powers, you know, turn four, first stride, whatever. It's so good. Two is nice too, because if you can keep up a hand momentum, you know, kind of in the long games, or if you just need to leave it in the deck for at some point, if you need to, you know, get into Brave, it's nice. Also, it goes into Soul, so if you're calling it by the higher DD Knight stride skill, you're pretty much just getting it for free because you're refilling the Soul cost. It's nice. It's a really good thing to have. Higher DD has kind of really enabled this kind of play style in the deck, and it makes it super strong. So that is the entire main deck. Moving on to the G-Zone. The G-Zone is honestly really simple. There's a lot of things you can play, but only really like six cards or so matter. So the big daddy right here is the new Fidez, Immortal Holy Sword Fidez. Playing four of it, you can really play three. You can get away with two. It's not super relevant. This deck is so fast that the majority of this G-Zone, it's kind of like the leaders. The deck is so fast, the majority of the G-Zone is kind of just like, you know, whatever. Just things that can come up in certain situations, just in case when you're like, you know, your one stride that carries the game doesn't get to its sub. So this card is pretty much the only thing you're strided after your first stride. It's so darn good. So two abilities. The first one is an act, counterblast one, and choose any card in your G-Zone and turn it face up. Then he gets the skill that if your opponent only has one guardian, the attack of your brave unit will hit regardless of the power. So if they have to guard it with a perfect guard or with it, if they have to guard it with a perfect guard, it will not go through because the perfect guard ability overrides this. It's not hitting regardless of, because the perfect guard doesn't care about power. But if you're anything else, like if you're a 10k guardian, a 16k attack, you need two cards. If it's a level k attack, they need two 5ks, you know, at best. If they G guard, they still need to guard with another card. It's completely insane. Combined with the ping pongs you can get, these are pretty much like you need 10 to 12 card hands to survive this thing. This card is completely insane. It really, really pushed this deck so hard. Like, they really wanted to push this deck when they made this card, and it's super clear. Then its second effect is GB4. Brave. When it attacks, if your heart is an alt mile, search your deck for any three cards and call them. This is insane. It makes the turns even stronger. Again, it makes it bare minimum like 10 to 12 cards to survive, given how much you ping pong with your multi-attacking grade 2s. Usually, by the time you're doing this, you'll have gone through so many grade 2s, you'll have a couple of these left in deck, and then you can just slam your opponent with loads of high crit power attacks. And this card's completely insane. This card is kind of the reason why I say a lot of power doesn't matter in the deck anymore, because as long as your units are just hitting bare minimum, your opponent still needs two cards to guard, so at that point, they're probably guarding it anyway. So this is what carries the deck. This is your carry right here. Your complete workhorse in the G-Zone. But to round out things with it, we have the thing that you'll be flipping pretty much the entire time with it. We have Holy Dragon, Luminous Hope Dragon. So this card kind of got a lot better because of the Fidez gameplay. You're pretty much just flipping random stuff the entire game. So as you go through the game, you can flip these up, and it makes this card scale really well to the late game. So this card has two abilities. His first one is choosing any face-down card from your G-Zone and turning it face-up. And then, after you do that, for each face-up copy of him in the G-Zone, he gets 10,000 power, and your rear guards with the brave ability get 1,000 power. So he will get really, really huge. If you go through like a couple Fidezes, and then you're like, oh, my opponent doesn't have a PG, you'll just be like, oh, hey, this is like 56 now, and it's decent, you know, it's decent. And his second ability is Brave. When he attacks, if you have two or more face-up cards with the Brave ability in your G-Zone, so pretty much always, search your deck for a grade 2 and call it. Then if you have three or more face-up with the Brave ability in your G-Zone, he gets plus one crit, then you shuffle your deck. So he's really good. He enables some multi-attacks on his own too. Actually, like, if you really need a way to get some multi-attacks going, G-Guarding, because you have a G-Guard that has Brave, so if you G-Guard, you can actually get the call on first stride, which is kind of nice sometimes if you don't want to go into the Fidez, because it may not always be the best option. So those are pretty much your two, like, biggest strides. Everything else really doesn't matter. So they're actually gonna be playing two Hal Blocks. This card is alright, I guess. He has two abilities. One of them is Brave Counterboss 1, he gets 5k. You don't really worry about that ability. That ability just exists so that he can have Brave in his card text so that his effect works. So his main effect is act once per turn, Counterboss 1, Soul Blast 1, and then Persona flip himself in the G-Zone. Then you search your deck for one card with the Brave ability for each face-up card with the Brave ability in your G-Zone, and then they all get 2k for each unit called. So he can be kind of okay. If you have just, like, literally nothing, you just need to pull a board out of nowhere, it can be kind of okay. For the most part, Fidez will do that, because he just kind of calls three cards for free, too. But this is a nice option to have, too. Again, like, these slots aren't super relevant. As long as you have these two, they will pretty much be doing all of the work in the G-Zone. Play one Brave Lancer, too, also kind of doesn't really matter. More or less just the same thing as Fidez, but, you know, if you get stuck, it can help. You know, just, it gets some nice power on. When it attacks, you can counterblast one GB3, call three cards with Brave, and then for each card you called, you discard a card from your hand. So you make the play with it where you just get rid of your whole hand, and You just go ham on your opponent. It's the same thing as Fidesz, basically just without like the broken guard thing. But you know, it's a thing. It's just in there as a backup. Then Blazing Sword Fidesz. We actually play one copy of the old Fidesz because this card can kind of come up. So his effect is act once per turn. You can choose a face down card from your G zone and turn it face up. Then you discard a card from your hand. Search your deck for one grade two, call it, and then if it has Brave, you draw a card. And then he gets GB3 Brave when he attacks. If you have a copy of him face up in your G zone, you retire an opponent's rear guard and you give 2 units 5k. That part of the effect is kind of relevant because we only play one, because you're never going to be striding this past, once you're into the GB3, you'll always be on literally anything else because this effect is really mediocre compared to what your other strides do. But the first effect is just search your deck for any grade 2, turn your card in your hand into any grade 2, and then also draw a card. Is really, really nice actually. Like, it can help a lot if you want to, like, if you want to kind of, like, if you don't have, like, you know, any of your grade twos that start multi-attacking in your hand, but you still want to, like, get your Electos going off, you can, like, use your stride skill to get your Electos, then you can use this to get your Levaro or whatever, or, not a Levaro, you want to get your, like, Slayman or something, because, the Levaro actually can't attack, when you have this on your Vanguard, because he doesn't have Brave, unless you're in the GB3 and you do get that Brave skill. But like, you know, you'll get your Slayman, and then you can start getting your attacks going and stuff. It's a nice table for a stride. It helps a lot too if they don't give you like really much counterblast to work with, where you're, it's like you don't really want to first ride the big Fidesz anyway. It's actually a really nice thing to have. It's also a nice thing too if you get stuck on the old Altmile, the Heavenly Decree Altmile, and you don't have any of your grade twos in your hand. This will actually be able to search your deck without having that stride skill to search your deck. So he's actually kind of nice. He comes in handy every once in a while. It's just a nice little backup thing. And then for our G guards are just as simple as our strides. We have three of the Divine Knight of Godly Defense, Egrain. When you guard with her, you can Soul Blast one if you have an Altmile Vanguard, and she gets 10k shield. So she's a free 36. And then if you're for Brave, she gets another 5k shield. So she's just a completely free, basically conditionless 36k shield, which is super, super nice. And then if you're a Brave, she's 41, so she just gets even nicer. But if you are a Brave in your G Guard, and you're probably gonna be going to the new one here, which is Holy Dragon, Defend Hold Dragon. Whereas when you G Guard, if you're Brave, he just has a perfect guard ability. One of your units can't be hit, no matter power at all, but one of your Brave units anyway. So he's really nice, like just like a one card perfect guard for like some big attacks. If you're at Brave, you can do some wonky plays to like turn him on and stuff. It's, you know, it's, he's a nice little addition to the G zone. And honestly, like, that's the deck. The attacks of this deck are really simple. As long as you have the right build, you know when to call, you know when to attack with certain things. This deck is really, really strong. I honestly think this is probably like next to Nubatama Dominate, this is probably like one of the best aggro decks right now. It's super, super strong. It's super, super fast. It's hyper aggressive. It's like 100% consistency. Like, your cards all just call whatever you want at any point in time in the deck. So you just have to decide what the best thing to call is, figure it out, and then just win the game from there. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. This is been a little long, but you know, I like really going into detail about these decks, going into detail about, you know, texts and stuff like that. I'm going to be trying to do some more deck profiles soon. This will be the first one we're uploading, so stay tuned for that. We're going to do some more stuff. If you guys want us to do some of the more silly decks we upload to, we'd love to do that. Literally any kind of deck profiles, you know, it's fun to go into about our choices. But anyway, thank you guys for watching, and this is the Chief Levi signing out. Thanks.